Thank you. I want to also thanks to all the speakers who came to Prague and help us basically prepare this nice conference for you, because I forgot to mention them during our thank you talks that we had during last couple days. So thank you to all the speakers who came here from all around the world. I will start my talk, which should be about how far are we from general AI, with a question. If I can ask you to raise a hand, if you think that we will have someone in this planet, we'll have general AI in 10 years. Okay, thank you. And now people who don't think, who think we will not have general AI in 10 years? Okay, it's more people. And now following question, imagine that there are two groups of people in 10 years. One group has general AI, and is like benefiting from it, and the other group doesn't have the general AI. And I want to ask, do you want to be in the first group, the people who have the general AI? So who wants to be in this group? Okay, so basically almost everyone. And now, who doesn't want to be in this group? Who wants to be in a group of people who don't have AGI? Okay, Virginia. So few people. Okay, I will continue. And then we will repeat this at the end of the talk. In this talk, I will talk about what is intelligence, what is the current state of general AI research and development, what we do in good AI very quickly, and some predictions, or something about predictions. The definition of intelligence that we are using in good AI is that intelligence is a tool for searching for solutions to problems. Basically, it's something that is narrowing the search space when you are searching for some solution to a problem that you don't know how to solve. And this could work by gradually accumulating skills and knowledge, reusing existing skills to build new skills more efficiently, and so on. And all this must happen under bounded, limited resources. So it doesn't have infinite resources, it always has limited resources. Currently, we are distinguishing between two types of artificial intelligence. One is narrow AI, the other is general AI. The main difference is that narrow AI focuses on one specific task in one domain and cannot work with more domains. And the evaluation, and this is very important, is usually measured how good that AI is on particular task. For example, how many errors is it making on image recognition task and so on. So it's really task-specific evaluation. General AI is something that tends to be or wants to be a human-level general AI, or should have a human-level or even beyond skill set, so it should be able to solve problems or learn to solve problems similar as people or even more. And the main difference in evaluating general and narrow AI is that in general AI, especially we in good AI, we are interested in how fast it adapts to novel or changing tasks or problems. So basically, the narrow AI is about how good it is a very specific task. General AI is about how fast it will be able to adapt to novel problems that you as a developer of this general AI don't even know they will come. So that's the main difference. And another example of general AI can be something that starts very general, but then specializes into different domains and becomes better and better in these different domains. So for example, you have this general AI that becomes good at programming, art, making games, writing books and stuff like that, but still keeps this general ability to steer its direction to novel new directions. And there are some key properties of general AI. One of them is, as I mentioned, this ability to go from general to specialized, to adapt. And also, and this is very important, to adapt its adaptation strategy. So basically, to change the way it's learning, to learn how to learn. And there are, of course, many more. This is a very limited list of possible key features that we need to have in a human-level general AI. And I will get to them later. And so current state of general AI is kind of interesting because, of course, like most of the people are not working on general AI. Usually they are trying to solve very narrow problems. But what I have started to notice in recent years or year is a trend where even companies who are not, whose main purpose is not general AI, but just AI, are actually doing research that you can read as a tendency or wanting to do something towards general AI. I will mention two examples. AutoML from Google, of course, is not general AI, but it's on the trajectory to go somewhere where general AI may be. Or for example, there was a recent paper from Tencent AI Lab, which is, again, not AGI company, and they did something on transfer learning, which is also an ability that you will need to have in general AI. So this is interesting trend. It's kind of like a small minority, but the trend is there. And so what the companies are focusing, because in the past, usually everyone was focusing on how good is their AI at particular task, what is the error? That was the key metric. Right now, some companies, these pioneers, are focusing on generalization across domains, so not only how the AI can do one particular task, but if it can transfer this skill to more tasks. Companies are working on meta learning, one-shot learning, or fast adaptation. All these things that are very relevant in general AI research. But what is true is that there is still a limited number of general AI specialized companies, or companies that's main mission is general AI. I listed only a few of them, and I forgot about Araya, so sorry, Ryota, but yeah, that's also another one. And there are some trends. For example, this is a... So this is a graph that shows attendance at NIPS conference, which is one of the biggest AI conferences. And you can see nice exponential graph of the growth of the attendees. And if it continues, there are actually some prediction that in certain point, there will be more people coming to NIPS than there is people living on this planet. And there is another trend. This is number of AI papers published on archive. Again, see, it's slowly growing, now this exponential curve, and it goes to infinity. So that's another nice trend, showing that we are actually getting closer to AGI. And this is another graph, which is very interesting. It's from OpenAI. This is logarithmic scale. So what it shows is basically how the amount of computational power available for AI research is growing, or especially AI power or AI computational power available for particular AI training tasks or experiments. And you can see that in 2013 or 12, it started with certain amount of computational power, and then it grow. And what they say is basically that in the last couple of years, 5 years, let's say, it grew 300,000 times. So basically the growth is 2 times every 2.5 months. It's more than more slow. And what we can attribute this for is there are a few things. One is algorithmic innovation. So we are having AI algorithms, deep learning algorithms that scale better in parallel computation. That's one thing. Another is that we have much more data, or we can generate more data in virtual simulations, kind of like infinite amount of data. But I think the most important is funding. And that's basically that there are people who are willing to put a lot of money into AI research. And now I think we can ask question, what will happen if this trend continues, or it maybe even starts accelerating even more, and what kind of architectures, what kind of agents we'll be able to get, for example, when we will have, again, 300,000 times more computational power in 5 years than we have currently. Because I can see that if there are people or companies that are willing to put a few million dollars into runs of some experiments, I think there will be companies or governments that will put $1 billion without no problem, and that can be really interesting. So how to measure progress to general AI? There are 4 different dimensions that I'm thinking about. One is architectures, another is training tasks, then safety and regulation. And by architectures, I mean the neural network architectures that we are developing, everyone is developing. Training task is basically how the agent can learn what we want from him. Safety, how to make sure that the AI that we will have is actually beneficial for us. And regulation, this is the societal thing, basically how to regulate access to AI or what the AI can do, who can do AI, and so on. And it's quite hard to measure the progress or even to extrapolate where it will be, because all of these progresses, especially on the architecture side, is very domain specific. And I will get to this later. It's also hard to interpret, and it especially doesn't say how all these things integrate together. So, for example, if someone has nice paper, nice progress in some kind of attention for visual tasks, and someone else has some different progress on, let's say, few-shot learning, it doesn't say nothing how to connect these two things together, and that can be the game changer. So it's really hard to evaluate where we are exactly. And now I will mention a few key features that are progressing. It's just a few of them. It's definitely not a complete list. I just put there some of them. Attention is, for example, one ability of AGI that we will need, because as I said, AGI will have access to limited resources. It needs to prioritize where to attend its attention, where to, what remember, what not to remember, and so on. And there are some work, recent work on, you know, in this direction, but again, it doesn't say much how this will integrate with the rest of the key features. Transfer learning is another thing. Basically, this is the ability of agent of transfer its current skills to different either domain or maybe outside of its current domain. So maybe the simplest example would be this nice OpenAI demonstration where they trained the robot hand in a simulation and then were able to actually transfer it outside to a real-world robot who works slightly differently than the simulated robot, but the transfer learning was able to help with this. And there are some many other examples like this. But again, it is, doesn't say nothing how these things will integrate together. Another is disentangled representations, and Irina Higgins, who will have a talk today, she will maybe talk more about this. And that's another very important thing. It's basically ability to disentangle, like split the different representations of the skills so that you can compose them into hierarchies of skills and so on. This is also a very important feature. Continual learning is something that Hava is talking about. Continual lifelong learning is basically ability to learn continuously, to not have just this training phase and then fixed policy of the agent and, you know, nothing changes anymore. But actually, it's about the ability that the agent learns continuously and is using the learned skills to learn new skills again. What we tried a year ago, we launched General AI Challenge. We call it gradual learning. And we had set of tasks based on ComAI environment, and these were like textual or like symbolic tasks. But what we wanted from agent was that as it was learning one task after another, the new task or like tasks were based on previously learned tasks, and we were able to measure if the agent is actually reusing what it already learned or it's just learning from scratch every new task. And also what we were testing for was if the agent is not forgetting while it was learning. Again, very important, and for us in Good AI, actually one of the most crucial feature. Fuchsia learning is another very important thing. Basically, that's the ability for an agent to learn from few or maybe one example. Because currently, deep learning, machine learning learns by having thousands of samples, thousands of examples, thousands of trials. But we people usually can learn in a very, very quick way. We can just see something, remember it, and use it. Another topic I want to talk about is kind of like surprises in general AI research and development. And there are two use cases that I want to mention. One is the OpenAI 5 agent that can play Dota game, and the other is AlphaGo from DeepMind. And AlphaGo won over human competitors, human champions, so. And OpenAI 5 kind of won in the beginning, and yesterday it actually lost. And the thing is, like, what is the lesson learned? I would say that, of course, there is a lot of things that we still may not understand what actually happened in these self-trained networks. But what is interesting is that some of these self-played deep learning methods can learn superhuman performance on very limited domain, but they still can. This is very important. And now imagine or ask yourself, what can happen if these experiments had 1,000 times, 10,000 times more computational power, so they would not simulate only 100 years of, you know, simulated play, but maybe a million or something like this. What would happen? But I think even more important question is, what if they were trained not on this very specific game environment, game task, but actually on a domain of how to design AI architectures? This is very important for me. So if you think about an environment where you can very quickly prove that the agent has this human general intelligence abilities and that can design or modify itself or parts of itself to become better at adapting to novel tasks, if you can really measure this and in a self-planned environment try to evolve agents that are good at this, not at playing games, but actually at designing agents that are then good at playing games or doing whatever you want. That's very important. And what I think is like very important thing is this one last line here is that
in AlphaGo, let's say that the agent reached the superhuman performance. So there is no living human who can play Go better than AlphaGo Zero or AlphaGo. And now think about if we have this algorithm that would be better at designing other AI algorithms. And the thing is, or like the lesson learned here is that basically all the architecture design, all the programming on AI that we are currently doing will become obsolete at that particular moment. It's like right now it's just obsolete, or it doesn't make sense to play against AlphaGo because it will beat you all the time. The same will happen with designing AI architectures, because at that moment when we'll have superhuman AI designing AI architectures, basically all our current work, or maybe even the work we are planning to do in a few years, will be obsolete in that moment. I think this is very good to realize. About AI training tasks, it will be kind of quick because it's a big topic. And what I think is that I will not have very specific examples here, but what I will say is that there is still not enough training tasks that will actually test for these general AI abilities that we are looking for. Even us, when we wanted to create general AI challenge, we really had to create the tasks ourselves. There is no like standardized data set that can actually test if the agent is learning in a lifelong manner and so on. So this is one thing that needs to happen. Another thing that needs to happen is a curriculum for human skills and values. So basically, in good AI, we call it School for AI. We started work on this a couple of years ago, then we put it on hold. We continue working on the architectures and we want to get back to this School for AI. But what is School for AI? It's just like children, when they go to school, they have some curricula, they learn one thing after another in a gradual manner, so they are using what they already learn to learn new things more efficiently. And we'll need something like this for AI, so that it can understand our world the same way we understand, has our values, and does things that we want it to be doing. And I think we will need to design this this curricula. And I think it will be a lot of work. Regarding AI safety, what I am happy is that there is a lot of theoretical research, a lot of papers, a lot of interesting ideas. For example, one practical example also from DeepMind is AI safety grid world, which is kind of simplified toy environment where some of these AI safety problems can be tested. But what in general is missing, that we still don't have testing procedures for general AI. So basically, as in software development, we are doing QA, quality assurance of our software products, making sure that they will do what they should do. In general AI, I don't know about nothing like this. And also, big question is how much of this, let's call it narrow AI safety work, can be transferred or applicable to general AI. This is something which is also where I'm also not sure, because there is a lot of theoretical research on AI safety, but many of these things, in my opinion, will not be applicable to general AI. So to know exactly what will be applicable and what will not be is a problem. And this is kind of like a chicken egg problem, because when you are doing AI safety, but you don't have the AI on which you can be testing it, it's kind of a problem. So I think this will be one of the chicken egg problems. And then work on AI regulations, and by this I mean the governance, you know, like countries, governments governing AI, who can develop AI, how to make sure that the AI is explainable, that people understand what the AI will do, so they can trust it, who takes the responsibility if the AI makes some mistake and so on. So luckily, actually, I think here, a lot of existing regulation is, a lot of AI is actually covered by existing regulation on customer protection. And so basically you cannot create product that will damage your customers, you know, because there is already existing law around this. So a lot of AI is actually covered by this, not everything, and definitely not general AI future, you know, things. And one of the things that in Good AI we are very interested in, and we ran general AI challenge, solving the AI race round, is this AI race and basically how to mitigate it. Because the fact is that currently there may not be a race towards general AI, but as we will be getting closer to something like general AI, the race will probably start to accelerate. And it's better to start preparing for this moment and mitigating it now, when there is still some time, than later when there may not be time. And what is this AI race about? Basically, there are two main concerns. There are many of them, but there are two main of them. One is that as the actors will be racing towards general AI, we don't want them to be neglecting the safety, you know, because they want to be first, they will just ignore the safety. That's one thing. And another is some kind of equal access to benefit of general AI for everyone, not just the people who will create general AI, but many other people. So that's what AI Race is about. I will talk about good AI, but there should have been video, so I will kind of describe what was there. And that's our game, Space Engineers. So basically, in Good AI, we are training our agents in this Space Engineers environment, which is a game where you can modify the environment, build stuff, destroy stuff, construct stuff, and so on. It's a three-dimensional environment where you can have multiple agents, they can communicate, and they can do all these tasks. And why this environment is interesting for us is that it's rich enough. Then the agents can communicate, which is also a very important requirement for development of intelligence. The agents can create tasks for each other, for the other task, by doing some actions or designing tasks, or players can create tasks for the agents and see if the agents are able to solve those tasks. And what is also important is that there can be some kind of self-play, so the agents can be creating tasks for each other in an incremental manner, like incrementally making the tasks more and more complex. And what we are currently thinking or like trying to solve is what is the minimal task for testing human intelligence. So basically, what are the minimal attributes of the environment that we need to make sure or to prove that our agents will have general intelligence, general human intelligence, so that we can focus only on these attributes of the environment and ignore the rest. And so luckily, we have some video. This is the second part, and that's the architecture that we are designing. We have been, like in past years, we have been designing multiple architectures. Now, entire team converge on this one. We call it toy architecture for some reasons. And you can think about it like this is the agent, and these are its interiors. And each of these boxes, it's, let's call it expert. And this expert communicate. There is some input, output, some kind of reward signal, some communication, and so on. And currently, at this moment, all these agents are hand-programmed by us, so we understand what is happening there. What we plan to do in the future, we actually want to use some kind of meta-learning or meta-search to discover policies for this expert, for these experts, because we don't think we'll be able to scale up the developing, like manually developing the policies for these agents for later, because there will be specialized case for specialized task. And again, what is important about this architecture for us is that it can learn continually, it can adapt to changes in the environment in a continual manner. In the future, in coming months, what we want to do is that they will be able to grow, so new experts will be added to the network, or new networks or subnetworks of the experts will be added to the network as new tasks are being learned, and there may be another parts of the network designing other parts of the networks and so on. So this is what we do. And summary, what is still missing in AGI? I would say the architecture that can learn in incremental, gradual, lifelong manner, so that it can learn in a similar way as people, that can do one-shot or a few-shot learning, reuse skill, accumulate skill, and so on. I think the architecture is definitely missing. What is also missing is the curriculum that can teach the AI, once we will have this architecture, that can teach it human-level skills and moral values. And what is also missing is testing procedures, something that we can run this agent through and know for sure that it's failing on these tasks or these moral questions and not failing on this one. Also, what can be very useful will be if something can be, some other process can be generating new moral cases, moral questions for the agent. So we'll test also the edge cases of the agent and make sure that it generalizes our moral standards or moral values even beyond what we trained it, and that it generalizes even in a correct manner. Regarding predictions, because sometimes people ask, even I ask actually, when we think there will be AGI, I think myself that any prediction kind of does make sense because it's telling more about the person who is doing the prediction and it's emotional thing. So how I'm thinking about this is that For example, nice example was AlphaGo Zero that caught everyone by surprise, especially people who were not inside the company developed it for. So it was like there is no Go playing AI, and then suddenly there was something that was beating people in everything. And it, for people who were outside, it just came suddenly. And I think a very similar scenario can happen with AGI, because I don't think it depends on incremental evolution of individual components. It's partially true, but then I think the last leap can be something very fast. As I described, like running some kind of self-play meta search for various general intelligence components in self-play manner on like extreme computers, maybe can get you this kind of result. So I think we are almost there. Of course, we are missing the main few insights. And what we may need is either the massive effort, so many people kind of manually tweaking little things in the architecture, or actually something, someone can have some surprise invention. Someone can call it lucky thing, someone can call it just like good idea, that will connect all this together and automate the search for general AI. And in that moment, it can just be on this planet in an instant. And so, for example, I am not really thinking about when exactly will AGI. For me, what is important is that I don't have reason to think it will not come in a year or two or so. I just don't have confidence in believing that AI must, like, for sure it will not come the next year. That's what is important for me. So again, I'm not predicting if we will have AGI in 3 years or 30 years, but I'm sure that it may come any day. That's what is important for me. So I'm preparing for this scenario. And now, again, if we can go to this question, so who think we will have general AI in 10 years? It's actually less people, or kind of similar. And who think we will not have AGI in 10 years? Okay. And again, this question with two groups of people, one group has AGI and is benefiting, the other doesn't have. So who wants to be in the group who has AGI? It's kind of less people, I think. Maybe they're just not putting their hands so much. And who wants to be in the group of people who will not have AGI, will not benefit from AGI? Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Marek. And we go into a quick round of questions. We are starting with Lukas Lienhardt. Lukas, where are you? Gentleman back there would want to know, do you really see algorithmic breakthroughs in the AGI space? Or are we just using more computational power and more data using old, also proven approaches? If so, what were your favorite breakthroughs?
Well, that's a good question. I think it's both. There are some algorithmic or architectural changes and improvements, and also more computational power. And I think we'll need both to get to AGI. And what were my main breakthrough? Like, I would say kind of nothing, because I am waiting for the AGI. So that's the thing that will make me happy. So even in our team, when we have some improvements, it's like, it's still not AGI, so I'm still not happy. So it's kind of hard to make me happy in this, but there is still a lot of things that, even as I mentioned, AlphaGo Zero or OpenAI 5, there are very good learning lessons for everyone. So I'm very happy that people are doing these things.
Okay, Joey Horner, who were there? Is the good AI architecture open source?
Not at this moment.
Do you want to follow up with a will it be? I think he wants to.
Well, that's a good question, and I'm not sure at this moment, because I also think that regarding the AI regulation, we need to think about also regulating the access to general AI. So I would not just quickly say, you know, that it must be open source. I'm kind of like cautious about this thing.
Fair enough. Jeff Thompson, gentleman over there. What fail test of deep learning would convince you that it is a dead end for general AI, instead of just convincing you to use a bigger deep network or train it longer?
So I think, like, if you just look on plain deep learning, of course, that's not the way to general AI. But I see deep learning, and we are actually not using deep learning that much. Like, even this architecture is not deep learning at all. And we may use deep learning to search for the policies of these experts in the future, you know, but that's just one way how to search for this. We can use evolution or anything else. So what failed, I would say like kind of everything, because many of deep learning approaches solve just one specific thing, that's one thing. You can also say that the architecture is not learning incrementally, gradually. The actual architecture, you know, presented in some paper, for example, will not learn in a few-shot manner, or maybe it's learning in a few-shot manner some super simplified data set, but that's not, you cannot generalize this or transfer this to more complex tasks and so on. So again, I don't want to sound like I'm against deep learning. I think deep learning can be a very good tool or framework for discovering what we need to discover, but just plain deep learning, of course, will not solve it.
And Andres Shavinka. Oh, we got a video, by the way. Anything you want to comment on, Marek?
That's actually different video.
I think, folks,
I think Tomáš got some other video from YouTube, so that's a different video.
Okay.
But yeah, it demonstrates that this is the space engineer, these agents, there can be many of them in the game. All these things that you see are made from blocks like Lego, and the agents, they can actually build it block by block, like Minecraft, but in our game, it's with realistic volumetric physics, and they can actually even program and do everything. And right now, these are, of course, people walking in this video trailer, but in the actual in our research, it's AI controlling these agents to do the things.
Okay. I think we should thank Marek again.